welcome to this meeting here in Tarragona. I am just going to take a few minutes to make a short presentation of the university. We are a relatively young university. We are going to be 25 next year, so we're going to spend next year on a celebration on this. However, we come from the University of Barcelona, so our areas have been working and developing here for more than 40 years. Since our creation, we have been we had a very clear idea that research is the mark of the university. So the many institutions use the name of university, but only those that are good on research can use this word properly. And we put some strength on that. Perhaps is that despite being a young university, we have been appearing in some of these rankings, looking at young universities like the Times Higher Education 150, or even in more general rankings and some specific fields like computer science. We appear in a very good, in a very nice position. We have about 14,000 students. 1,000 of them are master's students, 1,000 of them are PhD students, and more or less we publish every year 1,000 papers. So it's more or less that's the question of the university, and we do that for a fraction of money. That the money you spent in your universities. So I was talking with Salvador about that. that we are a good place to invest in that moment. If you know somebody that wants to invest on research on science, invest with us. We are able to produce, to a much lower cost than in any part of the world. Sorry, because there's groups like the group who's working around Josep Gris is a clear example of how young people, if you put a good project on his hands, on her hands, can develop a very nice project. Just thank you very much for being here. Welcome to Tarragona. I hope that you will have some time to enjoy. Josep, I suppose that you plan some social events. Well, this is the Tarragona, you know, was founded by the Romans. In fact, some of my architects colleagues say that the best planification in Tarragona was done by the Romans, and since then there has not been any further the development. But this is a you know, a very strong area with several strong legs. One is in tourism, obviously, but another is the petrochemical area and general commerce area. So thank you very much for being here, and hope that you enjoy these days here in this workshop. Thank you again.
This workshop is about co-utility. Co-utility, as you might have read in the presentations we sent you, is about enforcing mutual help, even in case of selfish agents. And this can be achieved. Well, we got the idea of trying to do this in the context of the information society, where there is no common legal framework that enforces cooperation, where people can deviate in an arbitrary way if they feel like doing so. Therefore, in the information society, it's especially important to design protocols that people are willing to follow. And if those protocols can, on top of that, promote help between people, then it is even more important. Then the objective of this workshop is to identify to what extent this cooperation among selfish agents is also feasible in other areas. And most of the invited speakers come from other areas different from computer science. So especially important and relevant these days is collaborative economy, for example. Also the environmental economy is an important situation, in which countries that have different legal traditions and frameworks must cooperate. We also have artificial intelligence, which again is computer science, but in another respect, well, another area within computer science. And then there is the ethics of the entire business. So there are people who claim that if you manage to enforce mutual help among selfish people by proper design of rules, people are still selfish. So is that really improving the moral quality of people or not? This is an issue that might be discussed as well. So this morning we will have two sessions. First, I will be giving a presentation on co-utility in some more detail, along with some of the main applications. Then Professor Salvador Barbara, who is a very well-known worldwide authority, world-class authority on game theory, will be talking about game theory, which is, in fact, the not the legal framework, but the formal framework we use to formalize co-utility. Then there will be a break, and then we will continue with the rest of subjects. So I think we might as well start with my presentation, and then we will continue with the game theory theoretical presentation. The idea is that each speaker has 50 minutes. 50 minutes means 35, 40 minutes talk at most, and then there should be time for 10, 15 minutes debate. I think that people being very interdisciplinary here, the debate may be quite lively, and let's hope that it will be so. And so now I should start myself. So I should load my presentation. We will be using that computer. Hopefully it works, and I haven't yet tried. So this is the, in a way, the conceptual presentation of about co-utility. The subtitle is Protocols for the Greater Good, and that this is the idea of the entire project. The website of the project can be checked here. All the deliverables are available here, the ones that have been produced so far. This is the team of in the group that's working in this project. So we are, the five of us are here at the moment, plus two more people that will be giving talks here, Dritan Osmani and Aveva Niguzi. So the idea is, first let's give an intuition on what co-utility is. First thing is to call about a protocol. Co-utility is about making protocols cooperative or mutually helping, even for selfish people. Then what is a protocol? A protocol is a sequence of actions prescribed for an interaction between agents. Okay? And in a distributed environment, for a protocol to be effective, the agents must be willing to follow the protocol. You cannot impose a protocol on agents that, if it is not in their interest. And this is a common mistake in many protocols, for example, in internet. There are protocols which were designed with the idea that people would follow them. And it happens very often that people don't follow them. And then you have malfunctioning. Self-enforcing protocols are not possible in presence that agents that act arbitrarily. So we restrict here to rational agents. If agents are completely crazy and have no interest that you can understand, then it's very difficult to design a protocol that they will follow. People that are unpredictable cannot be made to follow anything. So we will exclude this kind of people. Then while self-enforcement is essential, there are additional properties that can make a protocol more interesting. Self-enforcement is nice, but if it is not really in your benefit, or if it is just in your own benefit but not in other people's benefit, maybe it is less interesting than it could be. We focus here on protocols that promote mutually beneficial collaboration between agents, and we refer to those protocols as co-util protocols. And this is the intuition of the entire thing. The natural scenario to model this kind of co-util protocols is game theory. And this is why we have Professor Barbera here, because he's the one who knows. We will be using more specifically the model of perfect information games to deal with sequential protocols in which the current state is known to everyone. So here we view perfect information games in the usual way, using a tree in which the internal nodes of the tree are decision-making points, points at which some agent must make a decision. The name of the agent is labeling the node in which the decision is made by that agent. Then outgoing edges of the node represent the actions available to the agent making the decision in that node. So if the agent can make two or three decisions in that node, there will be two or three outgoing edges from that node. And then the leaf nodes at the end of the tree are labeled with the utility of each of the agents that each of the agents obtains if that leaf node is reached. Then a protocol, what is a protocol in this context? A protocol is a path from the root of the tree to some leaf. Okay? That's a protocol. Given a tree representing a perfect information game, G, a protocol, is either a path from the root to the leaf or a subtree from the root to several leaves if there are some alternatives allowed by the protocol at some point. Okay? For example, here the tree represents all possible interactions between agents. In this case, there are two agents, A and B. This node is where agent A makes a decision. These nodes are where agent B makes a decision. And decisions are C and D for A, and C and D cooperate or defect, for example, for B. Then in this case, if the payoffs, the rewards, the utilities obtained by the players are those here, where the first component is the utility obtained by player A, and the second component is the utility obtained by player B, we have here that the protocols prescribing CC and DD are the ones highlighted here. Okay, here, this is protocol CC, this is protocol DV. So this is first to introduce the formalization we are using. Then what is a self-enforcing protocol in this formalization? Well, it is important to discuss self-enforcing protocols because we want protocols to be to be the best option for people who can, for players or for agents. Because we want agents to stick to them. Then rational agents will deviate if they expect better outcomes from deviating from the intended protocol. And no agent, we want that no agent is able to increase her utility by deviating, provided that all the other agents stick to the prescribed behavior. And then, in order for self-enforcement to be feasible, sticking to the action prescribed by the protocol must be an equilibrium of the remaining subgame. Here, we say that the protocol P on a game G is self-enforcing if P is a subgame perfect equilibrium of G. In this example, it turns out that DD is the only self-enforcing protocol. Why? Because at this point of decision, A must choose or will choose the branch, the outcome, the outgoing edge that ensures the maximum least reward. If A chooses this branch here, maybe in the end A will get here with outcome zero. Therefore, A is not interested in getting outcome zero, because whereas in the other part of the tree, the minimum outcome that A will get, no matter what B does, is one. So for A, it is rational to choose D, because in the worst case, A will get one, whereas here in the worst case, A will get zero. And then, of course, once A chooses D, the best option for B is D, because then B gets one, whereas by choosing C, B would get zero. So altogether, DD is the only self-enforcing protocol in this situation. Okay, this is easy to see. Co-utility is something on top of self-enforcement. Promoting collaboration between agents is another interesting property that protocols can have. And if they have it, we say that they are co-utile. Now, a group of agents follow a collaborative protocol if there is no alternative protocol whereby all of them could get a better outcome. And this is called Pareto optimality. Okay? So there is no way for all of them to be better off. If that happens, we say that the protocol is Pareto optimal. Now, a self-enforcing protocol is co-utile if the outcome is Pareto optimal and the utility of each participating agent is strictly greater than the utility she would obtain from not participating. Okay? So now we are already where we are going. Self-enforcement and Pareto optimality are essential to optimum mutual benefit. If a protocol is not self-enforcing, it will not be followed. If it is not Pareto optimal, better collaboration alternatives may exist. So in summary, co-utility is self-enforcement, Pareto optimality, and getting more from participating than from not participating. Here we have examples. DD is the only self-enforcing protocol, as I said before. And DD is Pareto dominated by CC. So in CC, both participants get more utility than in DD. Therefore, DD is self-enforcing, but it is not Pareto optimal. And there is no coutil protocol for this game. In this other example, we have that FS, these two actions, this protocol, is self-enforcing and Pareto optimal. And therefore, it is coutil. And well, assuming that not participating would give a utility 0-0 to all players. Okay, if this is the case, this is coutil. There is another strong notion of coutility, which is called, which we call strict coutility. This is a especially strong case of mutual collaboration that happens when each agent reaches her maximum utility when collaborating. Protocol is strictly coutil if each agent reaches its maximum utility. In this case, we have that the FS is strictly coutil because this is self-enforcing, this is Pareto optimal, and on top of that, 2-2 is maximum both for A and B. Okay? It is easy to check that strict coutility is, in particular, coutility. Okay? Now, selfish behavior and coutility. This is the important thing. A coutil protocol, being self-enforcing, will be followed by selfish agents. It would be nice if we were able to ensure that selfish behavior always leads to coutility. But this is not the case, unfortunately. So sometimes we need to do something to make coutility happen. In some cases, though, coutility is natural. In a perfect information game where all the agents maximize their utility in the same leaf node and only in those in the same leaf nodes, maybe several of them, and only in those leaf nodes, selfish behavior is naturally coutil. This is something that can be deduced. Now we go to the applications, some of which will be further illustrated in the demonstrations we have prepared. First one is maybe the easiest, the one that is easiest to understand, this anonymous web search. Okay, so this is the case in which we are interested in submitting queries to Google without Google being able to figure out what our profile of interest is. Okay, so the idea is that maybe building profiles is good for Google, maybe it's good for the people wishing to advertise. Maybe sometimes it may be good even for you because you get the advertisements that are of your interest. But very often, the fact of being profiled by Google or whoever is not so good, especially if you are a secret service or if you are a government or if you are a company or if you have special interests that are not very standard ones. Okay. Well, an example of that the searches you do on Google may lead to re-identification is this scandal that happened in the AOL search engine in 2006, 10 years ago, in which a lady was identified. AOL was is still a search engine, but now very small one. Those people released in 2006 the queries made by a great number of users during 6 months. And from those released queries that were released for research purposes, two journalists in the New York Times managed to re-identify one of the people who had made queries in that file. So it is possible to find people from their queries. Then there are two main strategies that have been proposed to keep privacy when you submit queries to a search engine. One option is involves only yourself, and this would be done by hiding your actual queries within a set of fake queries. So along with your actual queries, you or your software in your computer must generate false queries. And then, so that in the end, the search engine no longer knows which of your queries are real, are authentic, were issued by you, and which of them are fake and were issued by the software. This is nice, but very often it is not so easy to fabricate queries that look real. Maybe the actual subjects that the machine can invent are not very credible. It really takes a toll on performance, and if everyone was using this kind of software, that multiplies the queries, the real ones, by adding fake ones, then maybe the search engines would no longer work so smoothly. So another option is to use a community of peers. In this case, what we can do is I have a query to be submitted, then I am embarrassed of submitting this query because I have already asked 10 queries about depression, and if I submit so many, in the end they will deduce that I am depressed. And then I may ask someone else, like Salvador, to submit my query, and then maybe he never submitted a query on depression, so for him it is not a problem. Maybe that even helps him disguise his own interests. So he might be interested in submitting my query. Maybe he's not. And if he's not, he might decline, or he might send forward my query to Jeroen. And then maybe Jeroen says, yes, well, depression is okay. One depression query is not a problem. I can submit it, etc. So in the end, we will distribute our queries among ourselves. Each of us will take queries from other people if those help him disguise his interests. For example, I never submit queries on soccer. I don't like soccer, even if I am in Barcelona. So, this is strange for me not to like soccer. Therefore, I would be willing to submit queries from other people on soccer. This might be good for me. There is a natural cooperation in which you use other people's preferences as noise to hide your own preferences. So co-utility in this case is natural. Here we have the first possible protocol to achieve this peer-to-peer query sharing. This is a case in which I ask one person, and that person, I am here, this is Salvador. I ask him to submit a query, and Salvador may decide to reject my request or to submit the query to the search engine. And then he gets the answer, and then he forwards the answer back to me. So that would be a case in which there is a single hop. So I ask someone, that someone says yes or no. If yes, he asks the query, returns the answer. Okay? So that would be if the person here finds in her own interest to submit my query, it's because it's good for him. And in that case, it was good for me to ask him, and it is good for her to do as I request. In this case, if this is followed, it means that there is co-utility, that we both are interested in helping each other. That person is interested in helping me. A more elaborated protocol, this protocol works well, although, the recipient submits the query if that helps her flatten her profile, but there is a problem. This single hop protocol protects privacy against the search engine, but not against other peers. For example, in this situation, that person learns what is my original query. So that person knows about my interests. So if I ask Salvador to submit a query on depression, and we are using this protocol, he knows that I am interested in depression. So the search engine will not know, but he knows. So in the end, it may be even more embarrassing for me that he knows than that Google knows, because I know him, but I don't know Google. So in the end, telling your parents about your thing sometimes is more embarrassing than telling someone. The same thing happens here. Or your acquaintances. Then there is another protocol, which is this multi-hop, which may be preferable. In this case, the originator of the query may ask someone else. That someone else may decide yes or no. If that person is interested in submitting the query, he will do so. If not, that person will forward the query to another one, and that other person may decide yes or no. Imagine that he decides yes, that the query flattens his profile of interests, so it is good for him as a noise. That person will submit the query, will get the answer, and will return the answer by the reverse path. Okay, so this multi-hop protocol is probably better because it is private. It preserves privacy of the originator versus the search engine, and also with respect to the other peers, because this person doesn't know whether this query originated here or whether it comes from another peer farther upstream. Okay, so that's better in that respect. Another application is ride sharing. Ride sharing is also something very fashionable nowadays. In fact, it was fashionable in Germany and in the Netherlands very long ago with the Mietfahrtzentralen in the 1970s maybe already. But at that time, it was really, you had to go to a place and then look for someone who was going to Amsterdam. Well, yes, but and you never knew. You never knew how this person, who was that person, so you took some risks there. And the person took some risks by taking you as a passenger as well. But so now this can be made more agile using internet. The most basic scenario consists of two agents, and there is an agent owning a car that wants to go from location A to location B, and each agent is interested in minimizing the travel time and the expenses. Okay, so both the car owner, the driver, and the passenger. The common way to proceed is for each agent to travel by her own means, and then the travel time is T and the expenses are E. But if they travel together, well, co-utility happens, because by traveling together, the agents can share the travel expenses, the gas, the tolls, etc. And then the travel cost, if there are two, is divided by two. Okay, if on top of that, in that country, there are high occupancy vehicle lanes or high occupancy reduced tolls, then there is an additional benefit of cooperation, okay? Because they can use these HOV lanes and tolls. The best for the agents is in those conditions, in those ideal conditions, to share the ride, and it is coyotile. But in a realistic scenario, there might be some negative incentives to this happening, and this is why we don't find so many people sharing rides nowadays. First, it may happen that the origin of the agents is not the same, that a detour is necessary for someone to pick the passenger, that their destination is not exactly the same, and there is again a detour that may be needed by the driver, and that also that agents are reluctant to travel with strangers. If you don't know the passenger or you don't know the driver, maybe you don't like to share someone's company. Then having different origins and destinations increases the travel time and expenses for the travel, for the car owner. This could be neutralized, this negative utility, by a compensation for the additional work in order for utility to be possible in that situation. And then dealing with the third negative incentive here, that is the reluctance that people may have to travel in company, may require introducing reputation mechanisms to mitigate concerns. So now if you have an application on your mobile phones and that application gives you sort of the reputation of the person with whom you intend to share your ride, you might be, it is less risky to share a ride. The same way you check the TripAdvisor when you go to a hotel, you might check who your travel companion is, okay? Then the matching between car owner and passenger determines how satisfactory the ride is for the agents. Travel time for both is fixed by the matching of agents. Profile reputation of agents is available at the time of matching agents. And the net expenses depend on the compensation that the passenger contributes. And the compensation given to the car owner is the only parameter that can be adjusted. Well, there can be a negotiation between owner and passenger. In this way, we can set up a right market where agents post their offers and demands for rides. Each car owner posts her offer to the market with the conditions that the suitable passengers must fulfill, as well as the expected compensation. And then each passenger posts her demand on the market with the same parameters. And then for a given class of rides, right, the rides that satisfy some conditions, the market has two different compensations. The expected compensation, which is the minimum the driver would like to get, and the offered compensation, which is the maximum the passenger would like to offer. And then if the offered is at least the expected, then there is a match, okay? We will later come to the reputation issue, which I leave for the end. There is another case of where co-utility can happen, which is the crowdsourcing, an example in the cooperative economy. In this case, crowdsourcing means outsourcing a task to an anonymous group of self-interesting individuals by means of an open call to the crowd by offering rewards for work. So I want this work to be done, and then who wants to work by this amount of money, for example? Well, this is the marketplace where people make offers and where people look for offers. The community is getting money by helping. and the crowdsourcers, the seekers, are offering money to get some value. This crowdsourcing marketplace acts as the link between the crowd of workers and the crowdsourcing sources of tasks, and it facilitates mutually beneficial cooperation, which would be this co-utility. Crowdsourcing is used by the crowdsourcers to publish tasks, is used by the workers to contact crowdsourcers, each agent acts according to her interests. Each agent is supposed to be selfish, so the interaction has to be self-enforcing, otherwise people do not interact. The game of possible interactions, the tree of possible interaction, guarantees that if a transaction happens, if someone agrees to work under the proposed conditions, then this only happens if there is strict co-utility. There is another application, which is traceable P2P, peer-to-peer content distribution. This maybe is a bit more complex to explain, but in the end, it may also be co-utile, and co-utile plays a role here. In order to protect digital contents distributed in a peer-to-peer network, there is a technique called fingerprinting. Fingerprinting means marking the copy obtained by each final user using a different serial number. If you use a distribution in a peer-to-peer network without any special protocol, in the end, you cannot control that all end users get copies marked with different serial numbers. So you don't know, you cannot make sure that the serial number of the copy obtained by each end user is different. If you cannot guarantee that, in case there is a redistribution, an illegal redistribution, you will not be able to trace back who was the one who did this illegal redistribution. So in order to make sure that every end user gets a copy marked under a different serial number, you should send the content to each end user yourself. So I am the distributor of the content. I have 1 million people who want to see my movie. Then I have to take the job of marking each copy in the million copies in a different way, and then send that copy to that user, to the other user, and so on, until I have done 1 million transmissions. This is very impractical. Then how could I take advantage of the peer-to-peer networks while ensuring that each final user gets a copy that is marked in a different way, with a different serial number? That would be the goal. And here, co-utility can be useful. Okay, you understand the problem. Using peer-to-peer networks, and at the same time, making sure that all people get copies marked with different numbers. So the idea then is that you want to embed a different and imperceptible mark in each distributed content, so that this mark can be used to identify the content buyer in case I find the copy illegally redistributed somewhere. Most fingerprinting schemes in the literature are centralized, what I was just explaining to you. They must be applied on the entire content by the one distributing that content. Peer-to-peer content distribution is a more cost-effective and scalable way of distributed content. We would like to design a peer-to-peer fingerprinting scheme to make peer-to-peer content distribution compatible with the protection of authors and owners' rights. And then we design a co-utile here, a peer-to-peer fingerprinting scheme that is co-utile for honest agents in the following way. We take inspiration of DNA. The idea is that the distributor initially creates N fingerprinted copies of the content, and the content is downloaded using the peer-to-peer network by assembling fragments from multiple parents. So a peer-to-peer network is like a tree, like a graph, actually. And there are some initial nodes in the graph which are initialized with copies of the content, fingerprinted, a few ones, fingerprinted by the content owner. And then at each step, when I am a user in the network and I want to get a copy of the content, what I do in a peer-to-peer network is to take fragments from different other nodes. And if I do that, I end up having a content that is uniquely marked, because I get two fragments from this parent, three fragments from this parent, and two fragments from this one. In the end, I get something that is unique, that contains the marks in those fragments here, then the marks in those fragments here, and the marks in those fragments here. So this combination, three from these, one and two from this one is probably unique. And in the end, if you have many parents, is most likely to be unique. And then what is and then a correlation test in the end can be used to trace any traitor distributing the content in an illegal way. Then why is this coutile? Well, downloading fragments from several parents is coutile for honest agents, because if I take fragments from different parents, then I will not be held liable for any misbehavior by my parents. So if I take exactly the same fragment that one of my parents has, if that parent made some illegal redistribution of his content, this can be, I can be accused of that. Because then the best for me is not to take fragments from a single parent in order to make sure that my final version of the content is not exactly the same as the version of any of the parents. So that in case they misbehave, I will not be accused of their misdeeds. At the same time, as a parent, I don't want to give my entire content to a single child in the peer-to-peer network. Because if that child misbehaves, I will be accused of the of the child's misdeeds. So I want my content to, I want to give only a few fragments of my content to any child, not the entire content. So by selfish interest, the protocol works. So no parent will give his entire content to a child, and no child will get her entire content or its entire content from a single parent. So, and that will ensure that the content that is obtained by any children at any stage is uniquely marked as it suits the interests of the content distributor. Okay, so that's coutile. Finally, reputation management. This is something that underlies most of the applications that we have been talking about, in particular the ones that involve ride sharing, for example, or crowdsourcing. Wherever there is some risk that someone may be undesirable, you need some reputation that reassures you, that minimizes, reduces the risks of cooperation. In this case, well, reputation management can be used to address some of the issues. In ride sharing, for example, an agent may be reluctant to travel with a stranger, and reputation management can be used to provide evidence of the past behavior and mitigate concerns. In the peer-to-peer content distribution, a downloader may not be willing to act as a seed. For example, if there is in peer-to-peer networks, there is a common problem, which is the free riding problem, in which people just download content, but they never offer their server nor their bandwidth for others to download. So if you are just a guy that uses the service, but you don't contribute by offering your resources to keep the service alive, then you are an undesirable person. And you should be severed from the service. I mean, you should be cut out. And then reputation can be used to keep track of how helpful you were in the past. So if you never helped anyone, if you never gave any resources to anyone, your reputation will be low. And then no one will be offering, will be giving you any content anymore. So that's also useful in that context. And of course, in crowdsourcing, it is the same. Now, can we use any existing reputation system, or shall we design another one? Why don't we use some reputation system like in eBay or like in TripAdvisor or in other services? Well, first thing is that since we aim at using our reputation system in distributed environments, the reputation construction has to be distributed itself. We don't want to use any platform that controls people's reputation, that can be bribed, that can be subverted or otherwise. So we want reputation to be computed in a distributed way. Also, if we want to use the reputation to make coutility happen, the reputation computation itself has to be coutile. Reputation is an enabler of coutility. So it has to be itself coutile. If people do not cooperate in a willing way to compute reputation, this will not work. It's like the electric engine in a car. So the electric engine must be easy to start because it is the one starting the other engine. So if the electric engine in turn needs another engine to be started, then the thing doesn't work. So reputation must be coutile. Then we have designed a coutile reputation management mechanism that is distributed and that is based on the eigentrust reputation mechanism. And here, to thwart the creation of fictitious agents, newcomers start with the lowest reputation. So if you had a bad reputation, a temptation is now I create a new identity and I start again and no one knows me and that's it. So now I get rid of my bad reputation. No, in this case, if you start, you have the lowest possible reputation. Then to thwart self-promotion, reputation of an agent is managed by a set of randomly selected agents. So there is no way to find someone whom you can bribe so that your reputation increases because you don't know who is in fact computing your reputation. And also to motivate agents to participate, the influence of an agent's opinions increases her participation. So with her participation. So if you never participate, your opinions will have a lower influence. The reputation is constructed by interacting, from interactions. So if you never interact with anyone, or you interact very seldom, then your influence on other people's reputations will be low, as it should be. Now, there are further co-utility applications to social networks, to environmental agreements, to collaborative anonymization of microdata, which is something we have tackled already, and the ones you can imagine. That's, in fact, why we are here, actually, so that people can think whether this would make sense in their own areas. Publications so far, we are still at the in the first part of this project. There was a conference paper, well, there's a journal paper to appear, there is a conference paper, submitted papers to journals. Some of them appeared already. There will be something appearing on Science, actually, in 8 days, in a week from now, where we mention co-utility as a way to anonymize data in a cooperative way, so that the subjects themselves, supplying their data, can anonymize their data in a cooperative way, and that's it. So that's what I wanted to present. So I more or less I think I did it in the right amount of time. So 40 minutes. I didn't check the watch. So that is. So if there are any questions or debates or things that you want to raise, that's there is time now for this.
Yeah, a couple of questions. You there are some deeper issues. You already kind of referred to them at the beginning regarding the relationship between utility and ethics. And so, especially when the overarching theme is for the greater good. So these are deeper issues that take a lot of time and have already taken up a lot of our time in the academic past. So I'm not going to raise them. But for example, could this also be used for criminal networks? I mean, you know, could they be schemes be co-util for the Camorra or the Russian mafia? Or
yeah, in fact, co-utility is defined as rational, mutually beneficial cooperation, but it doesn't prejudge that agents are good ones. Mutually beneficial, maybe mutually beneficial for criminals, of course. I mean, any technology you create has a dual use. What can be used by good people can be used by bad people anyway. Then the question is, when you create the protocol, you design the protocol. I mean, privacy, for example. This privacy in front of Google, well, if you are honest, it's perfectly okay that your interests remain private. If you are not that good, if you are a criminal, or if you are an intelligence service or a terrorist group, maybe it's not so interesting that your interests remain private. But but it's like helping each other in the normal way. So these Daesh people, they probably help each other as well. So mutual help happens everywhere, between good people and between bad people.
But now, since the overarching and great overarching aim of the project is to stimulate pro-social behavior, is the greater good. So then this becomes a very nasty problem that sits at the core of the project, I would say. Because that then dual use, as you rightly point out, that is an issue. But then that needs to be addressed, and preferably you need to think about protocols or kind of ways or mechanisms to, you know, to deal with that or tackle that.
The other thing that that occurred to me in connection to the to your reputation management is the also the ethical issues that have been raised around that. I mean, it's core, it's crucial, as we know from evolutionary game theory, this building reputations in direct reciprocity kind of thrives, you know, when we have reliable reputation mechanisms going. But at the same time, we see now many governments using what they call citizen scores and introducing all kinds of metrics that are supported by these types of technologies to keep track of the reputation of citizens. And so the same question comes back again. How could we have decent kind of or morally justifiable metrics and associated goals in place and prevent all kinds of dictators and other states to introduce metrics and reputation managements that are geared towards things that we would find appalling?
Yeah, there is an underlying assumption in all we do and in fact in all people do in most of the world, and it is that the majority of people is honest. The majority of people are honest, and then when you design a protocol, there will be more benefits than damage because most people in the world are honest. So that's one thing regarding this possible criminal use. Well, depends. That's a very pessimistic way of putting the thing. No, in fact, yeah. There is a most people have more or less acceptable goals, and otherwise the jails would, half of the cities would be in jail. People in city Tarragona has a small jail, but according to this normal view, they would have half of the city would have would be in jail. There is another question regarding reputation. Well, we always think on in a peer-to-peer scenario, which is a very open one. So it is if you are a criminal network, you will not engage in a peer-to-peer scenario because it is open. So you cannot control who is in that scenario and who is not. So so that already is a deterrent for criminal organizations. Then regarding a reputation, again, it is an open thing. Here, there is no one. The novelty of this scheme is that there is no one, no single entity controlling reputations. There is no government agency, nothing. So it is built by the peers that interact with each other. So your reputation is computed not by the government, but by every other peer with whom you interact during your life, in a way. So you cannot, I mean, it's social, it's society which is rating you, not the government.
Something. It's something I won't talk about during my talk, but I have some work now on demonstrations. And so demonstrations and the build-up of demonstrations and how you learn about others that might be interested in joining a demonstration and how people, what do people do when they demonstrate? No? This is an issue because now there is a lot of discussion whether demonstrations have been or maybe substituted by just, you know, clicking a telephone or whether this favors revolutions, whether it doesn't, and so on. And I wanted to bring just the issue as a further discussion because it's in a way it's different from that because there is no protocol and there is no one who is designing a protocol. Or if there is one who's designing a protocol, it's not necessarily one person designing a protocol, but maybe three parties designing different protocols that converge or diverge. So I wonder whether, so I just bring in the subject for further discussion, whether to see whether there could be any connection.
Well, you are invited to go to the demonstration and you go or not go. And that would be the basic protocol. So in a way, yes, it's some basic thing. Yeah. There's anyone else or in the general audience?
I cannot hear me. Okay. Hi. So I liked a lot of the presentation and the ideas and everything. To complement what has been said, what I've been wondering was more if you already started thinking about who would pay for this. I mean, I have some intuitions, but I was wondering, like, how do you think this thing would work, like, would at least cover the cost of it?
Depends on the case. For example, in the case of content distribution, it is clearly the owner of the content that would be paying for that. In the case of the in fact, the privacy in front of Google, this is a technology that can be offered for free. And this is, in fact, we have already posted this software, and it's available for download in case people want to use that. So there is no money to be made out of that. If there is someone that really improves his position as a company, then as in the case of the content distribution, then there is someone who is willing to pay. For privacy, there is probably for Google there is maybe no one. Certainly, Google would pay for the software not to be released. Maybe then for the crowdsourcing or crowdfunding markets. It's hard to say because any person could pay to get a service that ensures that the reputation of the entrepreneur is a good one. But at the same time, we would like the thing to stay distributed in a way, because well, you can pay if you are an investor, you would pay for that, but. This is not just about paying. I mean, in fact, you don't need to pay because you know that participating in rating other people is good for you. So you don't need to pay. There is no money involved in this thing. So you will input your impression on an entrepreneur that complied or that didn't comply because you know that if you do that and if everyone does that, the reputations will be more accurate. And it will be better in the future for other people. So in most cases, there is no one who will pay. But in the end, it is good for everyone to cooperate and to fulfill, to rate other people.
Just following on that issue, in theory, that I think is true. But there are several cases and getting more and more known cases about that ratings and reputations are not so free and so independent and objective as you expect them to be. And for instance, Uber is kind of making the way Uber is built up. The guys who have the taxis, they hardly can rate their passengers badly, even if the passengers made a mess of their cars and broke the car and whatever, because they have some kind of very high pressure by Uber to not say nothing bad about their passengers. You see the same in Booking.com. Everybody kind of feels obliged to give good marks to the hotels, or very good marks or very bad marks, and the hotels will kind of send you a mail afterwards. Yeah, please don't forget to send a rating to Booking. So in a sense, things are kind of being forced in one way or another. So, and then it's the kind of objectivity which is missing in the ideal situation.
In fact, we have a paper submitted on this reputation system that is now in the second revision, so hopefully will appear soon. In our system, you need not be afraid of submitting your real reputation, because what you do is that when you interact with someone, you send your reputation to a random set of other agents that are called reputation collectors that are the ones centralizing reputation for that person. So there is a hash, a function that as a function of the identity of the person that must be rated, determines a set of people collecting the local reputations from all people that have interacted with those people, with that person. And then from those local reputations, a global reputation is updated. But the precise set of people that collect the reputations for each of us, we don't know. So we have no idea who is the one who, I mean, if now you hear what my talk, and then you want to rate me, but So there is a set of people that collect reputation for me here, and not a single one, maybe three or four here. And then you will send your impression to one or of those four people. And those four people will update my reputation, but I don't know who they are. So I cannot take any retaliation against them. I certainly will not know who you are, who rated me, and which was the rating. Because there is an indirection step.
You cannot manipulate?
No. You don't even know who is collecting your reputation. You know that people with whom you have interacted will rate you, but the way they rate goes through some intermediate collectors that you don't know. So in that respect, the fairness is guaranteed. But you don't, I mean, you are not forced to say that, because if you say, I am wonderful, maybe nice, but I will never know that you were the guy who said I was wonderful. Or I will never know that you were the guy who said I was terrible. So you can... Yeah, in fact, this is one of the strong assets of the system. Yeah, if you use a reputation system like Uber or TripAdvisor, then there is a central platform where every rater has to submit her input, and then that central platform knows. Exactly. But in our case, we avoid this central platform, yes.
Talking about this thing, so we say that the protocol is secure. When you say that, you mean it's scalable at any scale, because some of this thing might not work if there are not a lot of agents. And some of those assumptions of security, we know that Uber, what they can do is they can send a lot of fake reviews. And in that moment, it might tempt even this kind of security protocol. Have you taken already into account this thing of too little or somebody that does too much? And then they create noise. Because if I'm Uber and I start paying people, then it's tricky. I'm just challenging. I know that this, I mean, you're advanced. I said it's very beautiful, but I was just thinking.
There is a, as I said before, there is an underlying assumption here is that you are creator of a reputation and you are the user of the reputation as well. So if you are creator and user, then you have all interest that reputations be accurate. And if you start inflating reputations by submitting a lot of fake reputations, then you are losing yourself accuracy when you want to know other people's reputation. You are destroying the system. You can do that, but then you are a loser as well. So this is a peer-to-peer scenario. So in the case of rights sharing, if you start saying, this guy is terrible, this guy is wonderful, then in the end, if everyone behaves like that, the reputation will not be reliable anymore. And this is bad for everyone.
So, if there is no more questions on this talk, then maybe it's a matter of starting with Salvador's talk. Yes.
Yes.
The question is, when you talk about crowdsourcing, you explain that when you talk about crowdsourcing, you say it's strictly co-util, okay? But the thing is that in theory it's strictly co-util, but in reality, the crowdsourcing, as you explained it in the paper, it has many drawbacks. I mean, there are many times the users cheat and tries to do the task in a fast way just to earn the money. So that my question is, can we say that there is a theoric co-util protocol and the real protocol in each case? I mean, because in theory it's true, it's a strictly co-util, but in reality it depends on any case.
This is why we need artificial incentives like reputation, for example, to make things actually co-util when they are not in practice co-util. Because a lot of things would be co-util if people were always honest and did their best. But this does not happen. And then you need some reputation system so that people feel afraid of misbehaving or of doing things in a hasty way instead of doing things properly. So in that case, there will be a bad reputation, and next time you will not be hired. In that respect, it is similar to Uber. So if you are a bad driver, you don't get hired anymore.